won't have escaped your attention that these elections, the first round of the presidential elections in France, have delivered an absolutely unprecedented result. It's the first time since the creation of the Fifth Republic, since 1958, that neither of the main political parties in France has a candidate in the second round of the election. This is the collapse of the Socialist Party in particular is very striking. Obviously, the Socialist Party, in the form of Hollande, have had the presidency for the last 4 years. And they've been delivered an absolutely humiliating result in this election as a direct consequence of the policies that that Hollande has been carrying out. So you've seen, for example, during Hollande's presidency, the massive Nuit Debout youth and what started off as a youth and student movement, which teamed up then with the labour movement and the struggle against the Khomri laws, which were a major attack, sought to attack the workers, the working class, the labour movement in France. I don't really have time to go into the detail about these things now, but hopefully we can go into that a little bit in the discussion. But Hollande promised all sorts of things when he was elected in 2012. He promised major taxes, for example, on corporations, on big business. And he promised to defend the work, he promised to protect jobs, for example. All of these promises systematically have been broken one by one. And as a result, people despise the Socialist Party. They don't trust it. And the result has been that in this election, well, first of all, the result was that Hollande was so personally unpopular that he was unable, he felt himself unable to stand for the presidency again. And his chosen candidate, or the establishment Socialist Party candidate, didn't win the nomination. Someone ostensibly, allegedly, more to the left, won the nomination of the Socialist Party, Hamon. But he too then, in this in the first round of the election, he got just 6.4% of the vote. This kind of collapse in the Socialist Party is far more dramatic than the collapse of the Socialist Party in Spain, for example, in the recent period with the rise of Podemos and so on. This is a real real humiliation for the Socialist Party in France. And deservedly so, rightly so, on the basis of the policies that they've been carrying out. And then you've also seen a crisis in the Republican Party on the right, in the party of Fillon, who started this campaign on polling about 50%. This was the open, this was the choice of the bourgeois, the open candidate of the bourgeois, who made no effort whatsoever to conceal the fact that his policies were ones that would attack the working class. And he too was ended up on a vote down from 50% on a vote of 20%. And he was mired in corruption scandal throughout the campaign, when it was revealed that tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of euros had been paid to his family members. That he was effectively using state money and party money to employ his family members. And this, for a lot of people, this just epitomized everything that was wrong with the traditional establishment in front of the political establishment in France. And he was therefore, and the party was therefore, punished in the polls. Now, an election, any election, is just a snapshot of general processes that are taking place in society, of the general trend that exists. And that is the case with this election. And the general trend, of course, extends beyond beyond France. The specific causes for the collapse of the main two parties, the Socialist Party and the Republican Party, they are, of course, specific to France, but in general, across Europe and in the United States, you have seen this collapse of the center ground. The traditional pillars that prop up the system are crumbling. and this is yet another example of that. The consequence, of course, then, in other places, and specifically in France, is polarization. First of all, to the right. We'll look at that first. Because what we saw in this election was 7.6 million votes for Le Pen and the National Front. This is the biggest ever vote that they've had. In 2002, they had a very big vote, and Le Pen Senior got through to the second round. But this time, Le Pen, the Front National, got 2.8 million more votes than they got in 2002. Now these votes, they came from largely the strongest areas for the National Front were the northeast and the southeast. The northeast is the ex-industrial rust belt sort of area of France, former coal mines there, all this kind of thing. And in the southeast, the border with the coast along the Mediterranean, the Front National for many years, has been exploiting tensions with immigrants, refugees, and this sort of thing that exist in that region. So there's a similarity to be drawn with Trump here. And of course, Le Pen's basis for this, for her campaigning, has been firstly, demagogically talking to the working class, in fact. To these people who have been abandoned by globalization and this sort of thing. And she uses radical rhetoric. Yesterday, she came out with the line that Macron, he is the face of rampant globalization in a world where money is the only thing that matters, where money is king. And she says she stands against that sort of thing. She stands against that kind of establishment. But this is the kind of rhetoric that she's using. And actually, you can see her demagogy when she came out with this statement. It was yesterday. Macron was visiting a factory in the Somme region, a place where they produce tumble dryers, a Whirlpool factory where they produce tumble dryers. And it's faced with closure. And he was meeting with the trade union leaders, basically to encourage them to stitch up a bad deal. Basically to accept his argument is you've got to accept the closure, let's try and get you a good deal. That was how he was spinning it. Le Pen found out at the last minute that he was going there, and she went along as well. But instead of going in to talk to the union bureaucrats like he was doing, she went to the picket line of the workers outside, posing for photos and using the rhetoric of he's with the bureaucrats, he's with the establishment, and I'm with the workers. And then he came out visibly upset, visibly annoyed, and then after Le Pen had gone, he went to the picket line and got booed by the workers. He has this tactic, he has this idea, which is used before, of going amongst the workers, like going and talking to his detractors, to his critics. He sees someone booing him, he decides to go and talk to them about it. In the past, he's done things like in the first round of campaigning, he's done things like go up, like argue with, get into an argument with a protester who's wearing a t-shirt and said something along the lines of, well, the best way to be able to afford a suit is to do some work, or something like this. Like, he comes across quite badly quite often, you know, he comes across as the establishment candidate. And on this occasion, yesterday, he said to these workers, he basically said, look, Le Pen promises to keep this place open. I'm not going to promise that because I don't think it can be done. The best I can get you is a deal, basically, is a deal where you're not completely screwed over. That's not what people want to hear. The people in these regions of France and these people who have been left behind by the development of capitalism, globalization, all the rest of it. That's not what they want. That is the voice of the establishment. That's the voice of the Hillary Clinton types, of the Tony Blair types. And this is only going to push people further towards Le Pen, and she knows that, and she's using this demagogic appeal to the working class. And the second plank of her pitch is the kind of that plank, you can see a lot of similarities with Trump, with his demagogy towards the Rust Belt, the ex coal mining areas, this sort of thing. Second plank is this question of patriotism, taking France out of the euro and renegotiating its relationship with the European Union, taking back control basically in France, the Brexit kind of rhetoric. This is her other plank. And in general, she is trying to appeal, and she has tried to appeal throughout this campaign, to the centre ground. Like now, in fact, in preparation for the second round of voting, she's actually temporarily resigned her position as president of the National Front Party. I mean, she'll go back to it, obviously, but the idea is it's just a nothing gesture, that's what it is. It's not a real move, obviously, away from the party and the ideas that it represents, but it's this idea that she's appealing to the mainstream, to the centre ground, this kind of thing. This is the image that she's trying to project. And of course, these things, particularly the second thing about keeping France, France for the French and keeping France safe and this sort of thing, she obviously got a bit of a bump of at least 1% in the polls after the terror attack and the death of that policeman, the murder of that policeman in Paris, just before people went to vote. So this has been the basis on which Le Pen has been able to build up her support, and this is the basis on which she has been campaigning and will continue to campaign. It's important to say at this point that Le Pen is not a fascist. As I was coming in here, I saw a poster of the Socialist Workers Party advertising a meeting saying, can a fascist take power in France? And the description described the National Front as a Nazi party and all this kind of thing. This is hysterical nonsense. Le Pen is not a fascist. The Front National is not a fascist party. If we take classical fascism of Germany in the 1930s, that came about as a force electorally and everything else. That came about after a decade of extremely intense class struggle, where the German working class was on the verge of taking power three, even four times. Soviets were set up, there were mutinies in the Navy and so on. It was only after that period of struggle where the working class was on the verge of taking power and was unable to do so for various reasons, which ultimately boiled down to a crisis of leadership in the working class. It was only then that the enraged petty bourgeois, the middle layers, who have been ruined by the crisis in Germany, only then did they turn en masse to an openly fascist party, which openly talked about crushing the working class movement. A party that never had any base amongst the working class. The Nazi Party never had any base amongst the workers in any election. And when you compare that to what you see today with the Front National in France, it's very different. The vote that Le Pen relies on is not an active, enraged layer of people who are out to crush the working class. Many of them are working class. Many of them are blue collar workers, as I say, in the Rust Belt and this sort of thing. It's a passive layer of people, than what you've seen with classical fascism in the past. It's a layer of people who are bitter, who are angry at the establishment, who feel left behind, and who are willing to vote for Le Pen and the Front National as a way of throwing a hand grenade into the establishment politics. Basically, this is the kind of party that it is. And there isn't the same exhaustion in the working class in France there was in Germany at the time that Hitler and the Nazis came to power. The class struggle is still on the upturn, if you like, in France, rather than on the downturn. It's only when class struggle is ebbing that fascism has any opportunity, can make any headway, any opportunity to get into power. And so when people on the left talk about, oh, there's fascism coming in France, Le Pen's a fascist, they do it because they think it's a shortcut to rallying the left, to getting people involved in politics. They think that's what scare people, that there's going to be a fascist in power in France, and therefore we all need to get organised and all we need to be socialists as quick as possible. They think it's a way of strengthening the left. In reality, it weakens us, it weakens the left, because it confuses people. It mistakes the period that we are in the class struggle. We're not in an ebb in the class struggle. The working class has not been defeated. It's not tried to take power and failed in France. We're still on the upsurge of class struggle. We're still at the early stages of this. And what's more, if you point to things that you don't like, things that are right-wing, there's no doubt Le Pen is right-wing, racist, xenophobic, reactionary, all the rest of it, of course. She's not fascist. You point to everything that's right-wing and say that's fascism and that's fascism and that's... Then you lose sight of what fascism actually is. And when it does appear, you're unable to recognise it. So to talk about things like the Front National as if they're Nazis and fascists and this sort of thing, it's dangerous. We have to recognise them for what they really are. We have to work out how we're going to fight them. But we can't mislabel them in the way that some people on the left try to. So you have this polarisation to the right, and you also, of course, and this is from our point of view much more interesting, much more exciting, you see the polarisation to the left. And you see this, crucial, the main point to take from the campaign of Mélenchon in France, is that it's able to cut across Le Pen's campaign. And this also relates to this point about fascism. As I said, fascism arises when the working class is exhausted, it's tried to take power multiple times, and then the petty bourgeois, the middle layers, they can't see a future with the left. They can't see the left ever being able to take power, so they turn in desperation to the right. But what you've seen with Mélenchon is the ability of the left to cut across the right. Far from people moving from the left to the right, you've actually seen things go the other way. You've seen Mélenchon's campaign start at 10% in the polls and end up at 20%. This is against a barrage of media nonsense, basically claiming that he's going to turn France into Cuba or Venezuela at a time when obviously there's all sorts of crisis and instability manufactured by imperialism and the capitalists and so on in Venezuela. All this propaganda being thrown against him, and still he managed to increase his vote by 10% over the course of the campaign. And of course, he actually got 3 million more votes than he got in 2012 when he ran, and actually he would have got more votes than Le Pen. This is another important lesson from these events. Another important point. He would have got more votes than Le Pen, not by much, by about 10,000 votes, but nevertheless more, as in he would have been in the second round, had there not been two ultra-left, sectarian left candidates, basically. Left groups who ran candidates against Mélenchon and the rest of the field. And that caused the vote to be split, and the result was that Mélenchon didn't get those votes, which would have propelled him into the second round against Macron. This is a lesson about ultra-leftism. I don't have time to develop the point now. We can discuss it more in the discussion. But this is criminal behaviour by people on the left who should have been in the Mélenchon campaign. But Mélenchon's rise, this move from 10% in the polls to 20%, it was really meteoric. Really, when you look at the detail of the vote that he actually got, it paints a really powerful picture of the mood in French society, particularly amongst young people and the working class. He got 30% of the vote amongst 18 to 24-year-olds. Almost one in three people in that age group voted for Mélenchon, more than any other candidate. He won that age group across the whole of France. And then he also won the most votes in four out of the 10 largest cities in France, including, and this is particularly significant, including Marseille and Montpellier, two cities that are in that region of southeastern France that traditionally is a Front National heartland. And Marseille in particular has always been a stronghold for Le Pen and the National Front. But Mélenchon was able to win there. And he was able to win in Toulouse, he got 29%, in Lille. These are the four big cities where he won, and in three more cities, major cities, he came second in Strasbourg, Bordeaux and Nantes. So seven out of the 10 largest cities in France, Mélenchon came either first or second. And this was the pattern like all across France, in workers' districts, for example, in Paris, like in the suburbs, on the outskirts of Paris, he came first in these places. In Le Havre, in the north, on the northern coastline. This was a city that was one of the epicenters of the movement against the El Khomri law. He increased his vote on 2012 by 13%. It was a massive, and he won that district. The pattern generally is that he won amongst the youth, and in the advanced areas where the class struggle is most advanced, and in the epicenters of like the proletarian heartlands, the big cities and so on, this is where Mélenchon won his votes. And of course he was strong actually in overseas territories as well. Particularly the one of most significance is Guyana, where they had a massive unlimited general strike just last month, and Mélenchon, and that obviously developed the class struggle, raised class consciousness, and as a result people voted for Mélenchon. And our own comrades in France, members of the international Marxist tendency in France, they've been reporting on the general mood and the mood in workplaces, unionized workplaces, cafes, just the general discussion in shops, on the street. Everybody has been talking about Mélenchon and his campaign. And particularly, they said, actually, among Arabic immigrants, immigrants of Arabic origin, almost all of them were saying that they were going to vote for Mélenchon, that he was the that he was their candidate. And so you see this, you can see this picture of a general, like, grassroots campaign, which was inspiring hundreds of thousands, millions of people to go to rallies, to get organised, and all the rest of it, all on the basis of a very radical programme, a left-wing programme. Mélenchon was arguing for a 32-hour week in France. For the standard in France has been 35-hour week. The capitalists want to get rid of that. The bourgeois want to get rid of that. But Mélenchon's arguing for a 32-hour week, and he's arguing for this kind of thing in a very radical way. He talks about he was talking in his campaign about how the rich were trembling at the movement that he had created. You know, they were trembling at the thought that he would get into power, and it was all very much us and them, haves and have-nots, and this kind of thing. And actually, so another lesson that we can take from this is a lesson for Corbyn's general election campaign here. Mélenchon based himself on, as I said, the media were against him, so he went for social media. There was a massive social media campaign for Mélenchon. He based himself on grassroots community organizing. He encouraged people. The campaign encouraged people to set up local organizing groups to campaign for his election, and massive rallies as well. Rallies which even tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people attended these rallies, where he was talking in very fiery language and all the rest of it. And even in the places where he wasn't able to go personally, he used holograms. He projected holograms of himself, which thousands of people turned out to watch. But this kind of thing, not carefully crafted media sound bites, not Hillary Clinton-style small focus groups or anything like this. Massive rallies, get people excited, talk in a radical way. This is the kind of stuff that Jeremy Corbyn needs to be doing now. So this was the situation with the election. Obviously, Mélenchon didn't win. He came just fourth, more or less equal with Fillon, on 19.6% or something, 19.8%, something like that. So we're faced then in France with a second round between Macron and Le Pen, a former Rothschild banker and a far-right reactionary demagogue. And so, just like in 2002 in France, where you were faced with Chirac and Le Pen, you're faced with a right winger and a right winger. Basically, there's no choice from the working class point of view. And like in 2002, as soon as this happened, everybody from the bourgeois to the liberal lefts has begun talking about the need to vote for Macron as the lesser evil of the two. And this chorus has been joined by the Socialist Party. Well, what else do you expect? They've spent however many years betraying the working class. They're going to continue to do so. And so they've joined this chorus. The Green Party has done so. And most scandalously of all, the Communist Party in France is calling for a vote for Macron. And we have to call this exactly what it is. This is a betrayal, a terrible betrayal of the working class by people who claim to represent them. Because Macron, I mean, we should look at what this lesser evil actually looks like. He is in favour of allowing bosses individually, not nationally or anything else, individual bosses to renegotiate the 35-hour week, breaking up the bargaining power of the working class. And effectively, it's going to be an abolition of the 35-hour week. He's in favour of sacking thousands of public servants, and he's in favour of lowering corporation tax, tax breaks for the rich, effectively. This is the programme of Fillon, dressed up in kind of liberal language, but nevertheless, it's the programme of the right, of the bourgeois. He is a direct continuation of the policies of Hollande and Sarkozy before him. There's nothing whatsoever. His election will mean a massive attack on the working class, and there is no way of dressing that up as something progressive. There is no, so anyone calling for a vote for Macron is demanding that the working class support someone who will attack them, who will strip away their rights and everything else. There is no way that anyone on the left can legitimately support that kind of position. Because Le Pen and the Front National, we should point this out when people, because it's inevitable, we will hear this from people, oh, we have to support Macron as the lesser evil. We should point out that Le Pen and the Front National, they grow in the conditions created by people like Macron, created by Hollande and Sarkozy. Who is responsible in the United States, for example? Who is responsible for Donald Trump winning the election, for Donald Trump being able to win that election? It's Obama is responsible. It's the US establishment that has created the conditions in which the rhetoric and the approach of somebody like Trump can win an election. And the same is true in France. Our French comrades have used the phrase that you don't stop a fire by voting for the arsonist. And that's exactly what a vote for Macron would be. He wouldn't put a stop to any of the problems that have given rise to the National Front in the first place. And of course, I mean, I mentioned the United States. That was a clear failure of lesser evilism. Nobody, like, that was the main plank, the main argument for the Democrats, for Clinton in the election, is that she's not Trump. And that was not enough. People were not interested in that. They don't want more of the same. They don't want the same old establishment politics. They want something different. And if the way is blocked on the left, people will swing to the right. We are in this period of collapse of the centre ground and polarisation. And already in France, now you're seeing protests, particularly of young people, with the slogan of neither Trump, neither Macron nor Le Pen. And so just today in France, 500 people in Paris, 2,000 people in Rennes. I say people, well, and they are people, but they're specifically high school students. That's the point. They're young and they're extremely radical and they're disgusted by the choice that has been presented to the people of France by the second round. And the police have met these protests, by the way, with tear gas, with a lot of violence. That's only going to radicalise people even more. And so I think this is the layer with the highest kind of consciousness. They recognise that there is no choice available here for people. And I think you're likely to see in the second round a high rate of abstention. At the moment, the polls put Macron on 60% and Le Pen on 40%. But I mean, if she keeps up, she's a clever, in the same way that Trump is clever. She knows what she's doing, and this stunt with the tumble dryer factory, like, you get a few more of those with Macron looking like a bit of a fool and Le Pen talking about anti-establishment politics. One thing she has said now, in the face of this coalition of everybody from Fillon to the Communist Party leaders calling for a vote for Macron, she is using that to say, look, that's the establishment there. They all hate me. They've all got the, you can see now that they're all actually exactly the same and they all want exactly the same thing. And I'm the only one who's standing against them. She's using this kind of this broad coalition of traitors, of class traitors, to bolster her position, her anti-establishment credentials. So I think it's not a done deal that Macron will. I think it's by far the most likely perspective, but it's not certain. But it's not least because I think you will see a high rate of abstention. And so I think rather than Le Pen necessarily winning it, you could see Macron losing it. I think it's possible, although as I say, unlikely. But in any case, we should also point out longer term, beyond the second round of the election, even if Macron does win, when he got through to the second round instead of Mélenchon, the stock markets went up. There was this audible sigh of relief amongst the bourgeois. All these articles came out about how great Macron is and all this sort of thing. And the BBC was producing endless profiles of him and so on. But Gideon Rachman, who's a journalist for the Financial Times, who's a little bit more far-sighted than a lot of journalists, obviously in the interest of the ruling class, he looks at things from that perspective. But of course, he cares about similar things to what we care about. He cares about the problems that the ruling class face and then gives advice on how to fix them. We care about the problems that the ruling class face and then give advice on how to exploit them to overthrow the ruling class. So we start off from a similar position. And he's pointed out, he said, hang on a minute with all this euphoria. If Macron does get in, he's not going to be able to solve any of the problems of high unemployment, of falling wages, of the need to squeeze the working class, basically. He won't be able to solve any of that because, he points out, Macron was the economy minister in Hollande's government. He was unable to solve any of the problems there. What will be the difference when he's president? So any honeymoon period, to the extent that does exist for Macron, will disappear almost instantly. And then he's faced with a growing Front National, emboldened by the fact they got their candidate to the second round, and a growing left with Mélenchon, as long as Mélenchon, we'll come onto this in a moment, as long as Mélenchon takes the right path now, takes the right approach now, you could have a very powerful working class movement as well. And Macron will be caught in the middle of it. So I think, unlike in 2002, where Chirac got elected in the second round, Le Pen was, and then there was this period of kind of general stability in France and the French economy and so on, that will not be the case this time. All the problems, all the factors that have led to this polarization, this crisis, this situation that we have right now, none of those will go away, even if the bourgeois get their candidate elected. And they will be faced with all sorts of problems almost immediately. Now, of course, as I say, Le Pen isn't a fascist. But nevertheless, she is a right winger and she needs to be fought. As does Macron. He's a right winger and he needs to be fought. Not voting for either of these two people it's not a passive position, right? It's not just removing ourselves from the theatre and burying our heads in the sand. It needs to be an active thing. Mélenchon, to his credit, I should have said this, Mélenchon has not, certainly not yet, come out in favour of a vote for Macron. He's stood his ground under enormous pressure for him to say, to vote for Macron as the lesser evil. He stood his ground and said no. What he's done instead is he's put out a poll, online survey, of all the supporters of his party, of his movement. And he's given them three options: spoil your ballot, vote for Macron, or abstain. And he says he will advise whatever comes back from this survey, from this poll. Now, we would say you should abstain from the vote because there is nothing to be gained from either of these people. But it's not a passive action, not a passive move of abstention. We will oppose these people on the basis of our own program, on the basis of a working class socialist program, for which there is an appetite. That has been proved by the events of the last few weeks in France, and actually I would say events all over the world. Because this vote for Mélenchon, this movement around, is part of a process that will not go away. I've just explained how the crisis is going to continue no matter who gets elected. And Marxists and the left and Mélenchon, we have to use this to raise class consciousness, to point out that the only solution to these problems is a socialist one. And there are plenty of opportunities now, immediately, for Mélenchon to mobilise his movement on the basis of an independent working class program against both Le Pen and Macron and whoever wins the election. He can take an independent position. He must not endorse Macron. He must instead, first of all, we have to see, he must mobilize people in the streets. It's May Day on Monday. That needs to be a massive demonstration, and it needs to be under the banners of an independent working class program. It needs to be on the basis of the program that he ran on, at the very least. And coupled with that, the union leaders, he has enormous backing from unionized workers and this sort of thing. The union leaders need to put on the agenda the question of a 24-hour general strike. The industrial struggle in France has been powerful in the last period. And there would be a mood, there'd be an appetite for that. A 24-hour general strike in defense of the working class against the attacks that are definitely coming after whoever wins the second round. And on that basis, he could flex the muscles of the working class, give them confidence in their own strength, and send a message to these right-wingers who are going to be trying to attack the working class, that the working class will not take it lying down, that they will have a fight on their hands, and give the working class strength that they can win this fight. And of course then, as well as the industrial plane, there's a fight to be had on the political plane, because there are legislative elections in France in June, very soon. And there is no guarantee, given the period of instability and crisis and so on in France, there's no guarantee that either Le Pen or Macron, whoever wins the presidency, no guarantee that their party will be able to win enough of a majority in the legislature to be able to carry through their programs. And if Mélenchon mobilizes his party and his movement to win those seats in the legislature, then that could have a very big political impact, and it would again give the working class strength in their own policies. But there's no way he could do that if he called for a vote for Macron. If he endorsed in any way Macron as president, he needs to take his own independent working class program. And crucially, and this is something he hasn't said yet, and his program needs to talk about the need to break with capitalism. He's hesitated from saying that so far, but it's obvious to many, to us and to many of his supporters, that the policies he proposes cannot be carried out on the basis of capitalism. This 32-hour week, better pension rights, like all this kind of stuff. French capitalism cannot afford that now. That's the reason behind all the attacks coming from Sarkozy, Hollande, everybody else. That's the reason for the attacks of the bourgeois, that they cannot afford these kind of things. They're taking back everything that was granted to the working class in the past. And unless he makes that clear, unless he says, look, the reason they're pushing for these attacks is not because they're ideologically just bad people, it's because they're wedded to the logic of capitalism, and we must break with that logic. Unless he says that, he's going to come into difficulties, basically, in his with his program and with his campaigns and so on. Now, I think that was most of the general kind of lessons that I wanted to draw out. There's much more to talk about, but we can talk about it in the discussion. I'll just say to conclude that we obviously, as I've said, we live in a time generally when the centre ground of politics is collapsing. You're seeing polarisation to the left and to the right in countries all over the world. And this is creating, I'm sure you have noticed it, a certain pessimism amongst liberals, amongst people who base themselves basically on a past period, a kind of New Labour sort of period, where there was a happy medium, a centre ground, where you could try and negotiate with people and get everybody on the same side, because the system could afford it. You could give some concessions here, some concessions there, in return for some horse trading of certain rights and this sort of thing, and you could negotiate a deal. Now, of course, that's not possible. Now the cupboard is bare. There are no concessions to be granted. There are only things to be clawed back. Concessions that were granted in the past are now being taken back because capitalism, the economic system, can no longer afford them. And liberals can't get their heads around this. They see this polarization. They don't really understand what it means. And they get very pessimistic about it. They see Trump getting elected in the United States. They see right-wing nationalist governments in Poland and Hungary and so on, and they get very upset. They see two right-wingers in the second round of the French presidential election, and they get very upset. And you also then get from the ultra-left to the liberal left, this scaremongering about fascism. Fascism's on the rise. Isn't it a terrible situation, terrible world that we live in? Marxists have nothing in common with that approach. We look at what's happened in France. We look at tens of thousands of people on the streets of France, fists in the air, singing the Internationale. This was unthinkable just a few months ago, a few years ago. We look at the United States. We see hundreds of thousands of people at rallies for a political revolution against the billionaire class. You might have seen there was a poll done in Ireland recently, which said that over 50% of people aged 18 to 34 would be willing to take part in an uprising against the state. That is the uprising against. That was the phrase in the poll. Would you be willing to take part in an uprising against the state? Over half of young people under 34 in Ireland said, "Yeah, I could have an uprising against the state if it were to happen in the next days, weeks, or months." I mean, what a time! What a time to be alive! What a time to be a Marxist! When you have this kind of thing happening in France, the United States, Ireland, and everywhere else, we are Marxists are intensely optimistic about the period that's opening up in front of us. Of course, when you have this attitude, when you have this polarization to the left, of course there's going to be polarization to the right at the same time. Class struggle doesn't develop in a straight line. It's not just going to be one triumphant march to the socialist revolution and the working class taking power. We are going to have a fight on our hands. That's quite clear. That's inevitable. But this, of course, is a fight that we are up for. It's a fight we realise is worth joining. Because the future that faces us is a future under the likes of Le Pen or Macron or Trump or anybody else like that. That's a future of barbarism. It's a future of war, Syria, Libya, that sort of thing. It's a future of austerity, situation in Greece and elsewhere. It's a future of things like environmental crisis as well. It's a future of barbarism. Whereas the other side of the fight that we are willing to join, is the fight for socialism. And for a world where the resources that we have, the immense resources that the planet has, can be used for the benefit of everybody, to provide for people's needs instead of being exploited for the profits of a tiny handful. So I think the main lesson is that from the recent events in France, is that the working class in France is entering the stage of history for itself, and it is beginning to assert itself like firmly in this fight that is gonna dominate our lives. This fight, it will be in the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. This is the question that will grip society, grip the world, and the French working class are on the move in this fight, and so our job really in France and here and everywhere is to get organized and join the working class as they move into struggle and help them as much as we can.
So as you all know, probably those meetups started basically the 31st of March last year. And they lasted for pretty much like until like the beginning of summer. They arised out of protests against the labor law, which was proposed basically in the government around February, and which has pretty much awful have awful consequences on the workers. It's part of the broader counter reforms of the Socialist Party government that is still on place right now. It leads to like unpaid, like overtime of the workers, which is unpaid, to employee abuse, kind of, and just to like kind of barbarism, as Ben was explaining. And so this movement began on how do you call this? Yeah, on public places like La Place de la République. And it basically like looked similar to the massive occupation of places in Athens, in Spain too, with Podemos and the Indignados, and also to like the similar occupation in public places in Egypt in 2011. And this whole movement basically showed a real radicalization of the youth, radicalized by the crisis of capitalism and the austerity policies of the government, the regular counter reforms that they're doing. And so every night there would be meetings and general assemblies that continued for a few weeks. And those nights basically gave a lot of hope to the left, because they really showed a revolutionary atmosphere and mood among people and among the masses. And so in those meetings, bourgeois democracy was heavily criticized, heavily thrashed. And this movement was also a big surprise for the media, because the youth was very much involved in it, and the youth, like in the years preceding it, were very much like they used a lot of abstention so that they wouldn't vote, and so the media would interpret this as the fact that basically the youth has like a political apathy and is not politicized. But those movements were like random students and high schoolers. And just not even like political activists would come up on the stage, defend what they were fighting for. They weren't even coming from any political organization. They were just sometimes just coming from simple movements that were fighting against some injustice. And so those nights were very spontaneous and had a very revolutionary mood, even though at some point it got kind of like bourgeois, like you would see like all those like bohemian bourgeois coming by and just like, you know, oh yeah, we're Marxist, but not like real Marxist, I should say. But anyway, and so, but those that really organized those movements really showed that the problem wasn't just the labor law, the problem was the whole world around the labor law, all those counterforms, the government. And they also mentioned the fact that the struggle was essential and that we needed like a general strike, which never happened, unfortunately, and which was one of the causes why probably this labor law was adopted in August. But so yeah, the social government, the socialist government, socialist, was very much like held violent campaigns against the workers, against it stigmatized the CGT militants, so the union workers, the unions, and the police repression was very high, especially during the demo, like on the 23rd of April. I was there; it was terrible, actually. But very revolutionary mood, and the Nuit Debout movement really like taught us many lessons in the left as to how to really organize the union strikes and demos, and that's, so yeah, it taught us like lots of lessons basically, and it gave a lot of hope to the left and to Mélenchon especially, because he was able, especially in his campaign, since he was really standing against the labor law, to get lots of the people. About 70% of the population was against the labor law, and he managed to like drag them in his movement of La France Insoumise. And so this really led to radicalization of the youth, who were tired of like the growth of unemployment, the crisis, the policies, and also the socialist candidate. I also wanted to add that the socialist candidate, Benoît Hamon, he was at first for the labor law, and of course, like, just like the Socialist Party likes to do, likes to change his mind according to like the vote, like the opinion of the masses. So as soon as they saw that, as soon as he realized that he needed to be against the labor law to get more votes, he of course changed his position and stuff and followed the position of Mélenchon. But yeah, so just, during this war against the labor law, the Front National practically disappeared for the 5 months, which shows that they're not really trying to get, they're not for the interests of the workers, basically. They just call, just like when Trump called for the workers' votes, it's just because the workers are like the majority of the population, so if you want the majority of the votes, you need to like get the workers. And yeah, sorry, so that's all I wanted to say. And okay, one last point about just the elections in general. It's just the fact that almost the four like majority, like the four candidates that got the majority of the votes, so they all got like 20%, which shows the enormous polarization of the politics, just like Ben said. And it was actually a shame, because lots of my friends didn't vote for Mélenchon on the basis that they're like, oh, otherwise it's going to be Fillon against le FN, and so it will be like right wing against extreme right wing, so they'd rather have like Macron, which is like kind of center, and get Macron to get the votes. But that was really a pity, this useful vote, because we saw that in the end most of the candidates got the same results, so you could have voted for your candidate that you strongly wanted. And that's what I'd say.